Hi everyone, I am Nazır Bilalyavuz and today I will talk about in-depth guide to the Postgres' new CI. In this talk, I will talk about what new CI is and I will explain how to use that new CI. I will give a couple of tips about this CI and at the end, I will try to fix one error by using this CI. Before starting, let me talk about myself. I am Nazır Bilalyavuz from the open source Postgres team at Microsoft. I have been working on Postgres for about 2 years and I was mainly working on build and CI stuff on Postgres. Let's start. What is CI? CI actually stands for continuous integration, and continuous integration is the automation of the integration. It is the practice of automation, practice of automating the integration of new code chains into the main repository. The continuous integration mostly consists of automation of build and test steps. And the CI's main benefits are it helps to find bugs quicker, also it fastens the development cycle. Let's talk about why we need new CI on Postgres. I believe you have heard the phrase, these chains are not working on this machine, but they were working on my local at least once, right? Actually, that is quite same for Postgres. If you are reading the Postgres mailing list, there is a very high chance that you can see something like this patch, these chains are not working on my local or not working on that platform, blah, blah, something like that, right? So our aim was to create CI to test your chains on various platforms. And the other aim was to increase the developer productivity. By using this CI, you will find bugs fast. Also, the review period will be shorter by the help of this CI. Now let's talk about this new CI system. This CI system uses Service CI to build and test your chains. And the Service CI is a continuous integration and deployment platform that enables developers to automate their software development workflows. There are a couple of steps to run this CI. First one is how to enable CI. I will talk about that later. The second one is push change. After you push your change, you will see the results on Service CI webpage. One important point is that this new CI will be available from PG16. Now let's talk about how to enable this CI. First, you need to fork the Postgres repository from GitHub. For this one, you need to go GitHub Postgres page. Then you need to fork that Postgres repository. There is a fork button at the top right of the screen. So when you click that button, it will fork Postgres repository to your GitHub account. After fork, you need to add Service CI application to your GitHub account. For that one, you can go this webpage or you can go GitHub, then click Marketplace. Then you will search Service CI and you will add Service CI by clicking this green button from your screen, Setup New Free Trial button. After clicking that button, Service CI will be added to your account, but you need to make sure that Service CI can access your forked Postgres repository. For that one, you can go GitHub, then you will click Settings. Settings is the top right of your screen. Then you will see, you will click Applications, which is left of your screen. Then you will see Service CI application. After clicking the Service CI application, you will see repository access at the middle of your screen. Like I did, you can add your forked PG repository to that access. So Service CI can access your Postgres repository, and when there is a change on your Postgres repository, it will trigger CI run. After trigger, you will see very similar screen to that. That is when the CI run and what will you see on Service CI webpage. So how this CI works? this CI reads Service YAML file from your Postgres repository. That Service YAML file is at the root path of your Postgres repository. You can go this link and you will see how this file implemented in Postgres. I will explain in details of this file later. Now, let's talk about some CI tips. The first one is service terminal, and the second one is gathering the logs, and the third one is on failure instruction. By saying instruction, let's think that the service YAML file is a dictionary, and the instruction is key on this dictionary. You can think like that. Now, the first one is service terminal. Actually, the service terminal is wonderful and very vital part of the service CI. Service terminal creates a connection between your web UI and the execution environment these executions run in. When you run any commands in service terminal, these commands are run on the execution environment, so you can always reach the execution environment and run commands in that execution environment. For example, when Postgres is working on your local, but you see failures on CI, it is very helpful to connect the execution environment to see where it failed and what is going wrong, right? By using service terminal, you can connect the execution environment and you can run any commands in. Another benefit of service terminal is when you need to rerun to CI, it actually needs the time to find available resources and it needs to rerun other steps. So this will take a time, right? But if you use Service CI, it don't need to rerun and you will save great amount of time. That is how you will run service terminal. There is a rerun button and there is a arrow right off the dead button. When you click that, rerun with terminal will appear. When you click that, you will run service terminal. The second one is the gathering logs. You can use artifact instruction to gathering logs. Like I said before, artifact instruction is a just key on this YAML file. For example, let's say that your tests are failed and you can see the logs on execution, right? These logs are stored some other place in the execution environment. So what you want? You want to gather these files. By using this artifact instruction, you can gather these logs and you can download them to analyze them offline. Also, you can see them on web UI and maybe you want to share them with your colleagues, right? By default, Postgres's Service YAML configuration gathers the log, the diff, and the regress log files. You can see how it is implemented in Service YAML file at the right of the screen, which is the test run artifacts. It is gathering the log files, the diff files, and the regress log files. And if you want to gather other files, for example, maybe you implemented something other, or maybe you want to collect the docs, you can edit this artifact instruction on Service YAML file, or you can add another artifact instruction to gather these new files. All that is at the bottom of the screen, you can see how these gathered files are shown in the web UI. You can click download button at the right and it will download them, these files to your local, or you can just click these files and you can see them on the web UI. Now, the third one is on failure instruction. Actually, the on failure instruction is more likely the helper instruction. By using on failure instruction, you can run any commands when there is a failure. You can use other instructions on and on failure instructions together. For example, you can use on failure instruction and artifact instruction so that when there is a failure, it will collect the logs. By using that one, you will save a great amount of time because when the build is successful, you don't want to collect the logs, right? Collecting logs will take a time because the service CI will need to upload them and will need to gather them. These processes will take a time, but you can gather these logs when there is an only failure. So the successful builds will be much faster And when there is a failure, you can do some additional commands to analyze that failures. Actually, the artifact instruction is implemented together with onFailure instruction in Postgres' service YAML file. You can see that the onFailure and the first one is onFailure, then the artifact instruction. So the Postgres will gather the logs when there is a failure. It will collect the log files, the diff files, and the regress log files when there is a failure. Otherwise, it will not collect these logs. Now, let's try to debug by using these tips. I created one example. For example, this one, cause of failure on FreeBSD. Now I will open that. And you see that the FreeBSD is failed, but macOS is not failed. Actually, that is why we want to use CI. Our chains can fail on some platforms and it will pass on other platforms. We want to find these failures faster. Now I click the failed FreeBSD task. I can see that it collected some artifacts and I can see which steps it ran. Now it looks like the Kerberos test is failed. I will try to investigate that one, that part. And I will try to find the error. Now I am looking at logs and it says that failed to execute command and it tried to run KDB5 util and it says no such file or directory. So it seems that the CI couldn't find executable, so it threw error. Now I will try to investigate the gathered logs if they are saying same thing or saying different things. First, I will look missing logs. I will open that test log file, which is showing the test log. I will go bottom, and you can see that the test is run there. Now I will go bottom, and it says that bailout failed execute command KDB5 util. No such file or directory. It says the same thing actually. It couldn't find the KDB5 util file. Now I will open this test log file. I will go Kerberos test and I will see it is log. Let's look if it says something different. It says can't exec, no such file or directory. So we are sure that it couldn't find KDB5 util executable, right? But the important part is, for example, I don't have FreeBSD on my local, so what should I do? Now I will go this task and I will click rerun. Now rerun with terminal access button will appear. When I click that, it will create a connection between this web UI and the execution environment. For example, now I clicked and I'm waiting it to rerun. First, it will be triggered. Then it will schedule the task. After it finds the available resources, it will start the task and I will see the service terminal. Yeah, it's scheduled now. And in a minute, I think it will start to execute. Let's wait. Yes, it started to execute. And now I will see service terminal. Yeah, I can see the service terminal. Actually, now I will wait a couple of steps to run. For example, this first clone the Postgres repository, then it will run a couple of commands there. Then at the bottom, it will run this Kerberos test, and I will try to debug that. Right now, I am in the FreeBSD environment, and I'm waiting this task to rerun to see if error is changed or if error is the same. Right now, it is building the Postgres. After building, it will run Kerberos test, and I will check the executable's name again. And yeah, the Kerberos test is run, and it says that same thing. KDB5 util, no such file or directory. So I am trying to find this executable. Where is this executable? So I connected the service terminal, and service terminal is connecting my web UI and execution environment. Now I will run some Linux command to find where is that executable. find name and adb5 util, and it will show me the path. Yeah, it says that the kdb5 util is at that path, local sbin and kdb5 util. Now I will look the test where it is configured. I will open my terminal and I will open the Kerberos test file right now. And when I open that one, I can see that kdb5 util is there and is used together with sbin dir. Now I will look the FreeBSD's sbin dir, which is that one. Oh, it seems that there is a copy paste issue because that one should sbin, right? Because we searched that path by using search terminal and it says sbin. Now I will my change. Now I am committing it. And I will push. After pushing, the service CI will read my Postgres repository and it will trigger new CI run. On this CI run, I'm expecting it FreeBSD to pass. Let's see service CI web page. I'm opening that one. You can see that auto canceled because of the newer build. So the service CI able to detect or change and it triggered this new task. Yeah, we have macOS and FreeBSD tasks and FreeBSD is started to run. Now let's look at that. Like it did, it will clone Postgres repository, then it will run a couple of commands. After that, it will configure and build Postgres. Then it will run the Kerberos test and we expect the Kerberos test to be passed. Let's wait a couple of minutes. Actually, it will run faster, I think. It will be finished in a minute. Yeah, it configured. And right now it is building. You can see, for example, the build logs here. After the building, it will run this Kerberos test. And yes, it is running Kerberos test right now. And yeah, like we expected, it passed. And you can see that it didn't run artifact instructions because the test is succeed. I mean, because the build is succeed. So there is no need to collect these test log files. If I go back, you can see that FreeBSD is passed. We can go back to slides. Yeah, we debug one error by using a couple of tips. Now let's talk about that service YAML file. Actually, the service YAML file consists of six main parts, and I will try to see basic service YAML file to explain what are these parts. We can go back to my screen, and now I will open my terminal. I will go back to my repository and I will open that service YAML file. The service YAML file consists of six main parts, which are the task, the name, the container, the env, the script, and the artifact instructions. Task instruction is actually a sequence of instructions to execute and an execution environment to execute these instructions in. Task instruction is a top-level instruction, and the other instructions are defined under this task instruction. We have the name that is simple. It is name of the CI task. For example, our CI task will be Postgres CI Citus Con talk. Then there is a container instruction. Container is where CI will run. It will define the container's properties. For example, we have container configuration. We will use Debian here. Its CPU will be 4 and its memory will be 12. We have environment variables here under the env instruction. That is where the environment variables are configured. For example, we have the event name. environment variable and file name environment variable. We can use these environment variables under the other instructions. We have the script instruction. We can use script instruction to execute commands in the execution environment. Right now, we have the print post type script instruction. For example, we have these commands, echo, hi everyone, and echo, this talk is given at event name, which is configured at under the environment variables, which is talk.txt. So, the event name is question mark here, but we are writing this change to file name, which is talk.txt. And we have artifact instruction. Artifact instruction is instruction to store files and expose them in the UR for dynamic later. When we use that instruction, it will store these logs in the cloud, and we can download and look these files from web UI. We have the block artifacts. So we set the paths to file name, which was talk.txt here. So we will collect the talk.txt, and its type will be text. One quick note, we didn't use onFailure instruction, so it will collect this talk.txt. If the whether build succeed or not, it will collect this talk.txt. So right now, what I will do is I will change that event name, and I will make it the Citus Con. So what I expect is it will say, hi everyone, we can see that from Citus CI. Then it will say that this talk is given at Citus Con, but it will write this string to talk.txt, and the service CI will collect these logs. Then we can look this log from web UI. Now I will save it. I will commit it, then I will push it. Citus Con, and I will push it. Now I will see that service CI will run, and it will say this talk is given at Citus Con, but we will see in we will see that in gathered logs. Let's look at that one. So let's go to that service playground service CI task, and we can see it run the Citus Con right now, and it created like 30 seconds ago. So we triggered that one, it finished, it succeed, and that was the commit message, the Citus Con. That was the commit hash, and that was the branch. Right now, we can see that the Postgres CI Citus Con talk. And when I click that, I will see that it collected some artifacts. Like it will, when I go here, it says, hi everyone, and this talk is given at, which was Citus Con. We set that at the Citus Con, and we can see that from here, it is Citus Con, and the file name is talk.txt. So it says that this talk is given at Citus Con, and it writes it to talk.txt, and Citus Citus CI is actually collected these logs. So let's see talk.txt. Yeah, as we expected, it says that this talk is given at Citus Con. We can go back to slides. Actually, that was the end of my talk. To sum it up, we talk about how to enable service CI on GitHub. When we push some change on our GitHub repository, it will trigger service CI, and this service CI will read service YAML file from root path of the Postgres directory, and it will configure its tasks by reading this service YAML file. After that, we will see this CI run on the service CI web page. And when there is a failure, we can use service terminal to connect execution environment, maybe to debug it or to see some logs or to run any commands. And we can gather some logs by using artifact instruction. we can collect the test log files or build files or maybe docs by using that artifact instruction. And we can use onFailure instruction if needed. By using onFailure instruction together with other instructions, these instructions will run when there is a failure. So it will save a great amount of time, I mean, by using onFailure instruction. Yeah, that was end of my talk. Thank you for listening. And if you have any questions, you can reach me by Microsoft Open Source Discord channel, or you can use comments to reach me, or you can email me directly, or you can tweet me or tag me. Thank you for listening.